We use the word contrast a lot in digital photography. In most contexts, this word, contrast, means the push and pull of tones away from medium gray. We talk about contrast a lot because contrast is often the secret sauce that makes an image come alive. Let me show you a quick demo of what contrast means using this image of a horse out grazing in a field. I've added a tone chart, that stripe of gray, that goes all the way from inky black to paper white to the top of this image too, on the hopes that it will help you better understand what's going on in here when we mess with the contrast controls. If I go into Snapseed's Tune Image Toolset, and then I go to the Tune Image menu, and I go to the Contrast control, watch as I slide this slider up by swiping one finger to the right across the screen, how the low tones on the left side of that chart get darker, while all of the high tones on the right side get brighter. See how the dark areas in this image, like the horse or those shadows under the trees, are getting darker too, while the light areas, like the leaves on the trees, get brighter. If I crank things all the way up to plus 100 in here, then the image is just too stark. Pushing our tones this far obliterates details that we want to see at both ends of the spectrum. I'm pushing things all the way up here to the extreme to make a point about what contrast ordinarily does to our tones in Snapseed from Google. The thing that I really want you to notice here is that adding contrast this way is changing the whole image. I'm going to cancel this change because I want to show you an elegant alternative. Down here in the Tools and Filters list is an option called Tonal Contrast. As soon as this filter loads, I'm going to tap on the Adjust button down here on the toolbar. I'm going to tap on Adjust right away because this filter always launches with some default settings in place. The defaults that the Google engineers have chosen are not doing any harm to my image, but they're just generic settings that may or may not be an appropriate choice for the photo that you are working on. I'm going to swipe one finger across the screen real quick to zero out the high tone settings. Now, I'll swipe vertically to bring up this filter's menu, and I'll repeat this process for the mid-tones, and then finally, for the low tones controls. Okay, now that I have zeroed everything out, I'm going to swipe vertically again and switch back over to the high tones control. Watch those little white flowers in the field around the horse as I start to add some contrast to the high tones. I'm going to double tap here to zoom in so you can see what's really going on. In this photo, that fence and those flowers are very bright, almost white shades of gray. Those are the high tones, but they're not uniform. Mixed in amongst the bright tones are slightly darker shades of gray too. If you look carefully at the fence line, you will see little spots where some of the paint has flaked off. Those areas where the paint is gone are still bright, but just not as bright as the areas that surround them. When I tap on the before after button, can you still see those flaky areas? The same down in the field. When I crank the high tones contrast up in here, what I'm telling this app to do is to push these bright tones further apart. Notice how when I tap the before and after again, how there is no change to the horse? There is no change because none of the shades of gray in the horse are high tones. I'm going to zero the high tones contrast slider out again, just for this demo. Now, I'm going to swipe up and switch over to the mid-tones control. When I swipe to the right now with one finger, I'm adding contrast to the shades of gray that are the mid-tones. It's easy to overdo it here, but notice how the lighter parts of the horse are getting brighter and the darker parts are getting darker. Now, I don't want you to get the wrong idea. Tonal contrast is not a selective tool that knows what a horse or a flower or any object looks like. I'm not saying that Snapseed only changes this specific object. Instead, what tonal contrast knows is that within each range of tones, say the mids or the shadows, that there are variations between individual shades of gray. Cranking this one up accentuates those variations. Let me set this one down to about plus 40. Now, I liked the additional detail that the high tones was adding, so let me swipe up again. And then let me set that one to about plus 70 or so. I'll zoom out, and now I'm going to commit these changes and return to the home screen. Watch once more when I press a single finger against the screen. What a difference accentuating the subtle differences between the mid and high tones makes in this image. What you are looking at right now is the difference between global contrast, where we are changing every bit of the image with a sledgehammer, and fine contrast, where we are targeting our changes to a smaller range of tones. I should save my work at this point, but let me open up another image here to show you what a blessing this filter can be when you're working on your landscape or travel images. So here is a full-color image that I shot with my smartphone at one of my favorite lighthouses on the coast of Maine. There is nothing wrong with this image in color, but since we are talking about fine contrast and shades of gray, let's turn this one into a black and white. As you know by now, there are many ways that I could take the color away, but my favorite method here in Snapseed is the black and white filter. Once the black and white filter launches, I always start with the color filter option. Remember that the filters in here will lighten up things that are the same color as the filter and darken down the areas that are 180 degrees away from the filter's color on a photographer's color wheel. Blue, nope. See, this one is making all that blue sky into an almost paper white sky. In this image, that's no good. Green, better. Much better. But now the areas that were in red in the flag are losing contrast. Orange. Perfect. Now I have good contrast in the sky and in the flag. At this point, I might as well tap on the Adjust button and try the Global Contrast slider that lives inside of this filter. Plus 30 or so here looks pretty good, but if I crank this one all the way up to plus 100, then things look terrible. It's just way too much. I'm going to back this one down to about plus 15 because I think that this image benefits from the addition of a little global contrast. If I wanted even more precision here, I could leave this slider at zero and then go work with the curves tool instead. Let me commit our black and white conversion now, and then let's add some real punch with precision using that tonal contrast filter. Bam! Even with the default settings, this image is already looking better. What I hope you are noticing is that the tonal contrast filter really accentuates textures and fine details. Adding this type of fine targeted contrast adds a feeling of a sharper, crisper detail into our images. With that in mind, I think I'll bring out more texture in the clouds by raising the high tone settings to about 70. Now, of course, this change to the high tones is also going to affect the lighthouse and the fence line, since they too are both made of bright, almost paper white pixels. In this image, more texture and more detail in the building is fine, since that's the dominant subject of the photograph. I'm going to double tap here to zoom in over this little Fisherman's Museum sign. When we use the tonal contrast filter, we need to be careful not to overdo things. Do you see how that wall around the sign is starting to look a little grainy? The wall is starting to show too much texture, I believe, because the default setting for the midtones right now is adding too much fine contrast into this tonal range. Yeah, see, too much. Let's lower this one down to about plus 20. I'm going to zoom back out. Finally, I'm going to swipe vertically once more, and now I'm going to think carefully about those low tones. Before I change the low tones, I need to zoom in here over this building where those dark gray roof tiles live, since those are the most noticeable low tones in this image. See how adding more contrast here makes those dark gray roof tiles more noticeable? In this case, I think that those tiles and all of the dark tones are a pretty minor part of this composition. So I'm going to set this one down to zero. I'll zoom back out, and then I'll show you the complete before and after. Here's the real lesson. Our eyes love this fine contrast stuff. This kind of contrast commands our attention. Adding fine contrast pushes and pulls our eyes around the image. So my advice is, don't overdo it. What you see here, not the numbers, but the pattern, where I'm adding a significant amount of tonal contrast to one set of tones, a little adjustment to another range, and none for the third, is what I usually do in here for all of my black and white images. Well, let me rephrase that. I love this tonal contrast control for landscapes and travel shots, but I would be wary about using it on a portrait, particularly a close-up headshot or a selfie. Most people are not going to like it when you accentuate all of the texture in our skin. Making the pores and wrinkles in our faces pop out is probably not the look that most people want for their portrait, but in a scene like this, it works great. One more. So far, I've been working with black and white images in this tutorial. This time, let me show you what this filter can do for us in a color photo. Now, I'm going to skip over all of the other tools that I ordinarily use here in Snapseed with an image like this one, just to keep this demo moving. But please remember that there are lots of other features that I would usually use before jumping into the tonal contrast control. With a full color image, we can use tonal contrast to give our images an over-the-top HDR processed look. If you crank things up in here with a color landscape shot like this one, then every texture in the clouds and the rocks gets accentuated. Some people love this heavy HDR look, and I will admit that there are times when this noticeable style of image processing works, but most of the time, this is something that I try to avoid in my photography. Let me swipe all of these sliders back to zero. And then I need to sit back and think a second. Even though this image is in color, it still has bright tones, like the sky. It has mid-tones, like those amazing cliff walls, and has low tones, like the dark sagebrush on the far left. Since this fine contrast will command my viewer's attention, I only want to add it to the tonal range that matters the most to me in this image. For me, that's those cliffs. Again, to be clear, this tool does not know anything about cliffs, clouds, or sagebrush. If I wanted that kind of precision, I need to turn to other tools. But my point is that if the texture and the details in the cliffs are accentuated, then that's where your eyes are going to go in this photo. And those cliffs are not the brightest or the darkest parts of this image. So it's the mid-tones contrast that I need to change. That looks good to me. There's going to be some change to my sky because I picked the mids. There are medium shades up there in the clouds, and there are some mid-tones in the soil around the sagebrush. But all in all now, my eye is subtly being drawn to the textures and the details in the cliffs. I think this is awesome. Instead of the sledgehammer that is global contrast, now I'm adding definition to this image with far more elegance and precision. My advice is use this incredible filter on all of your black and white landscape and travel shots. Try this filter out on your color landscape images too, but keep it subtle unless you were intentionally going for that extra crispy HDR look. I hope you found this lesson useful. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in our next tutorial.